to the 12th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee here in 2022, for the avoidance of doubt. Our first agenda item this morning is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those petitions is petition number 1887 to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, lodged by Nicola Murray. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, creating a specific offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic abuse, which causes a miscarriage. We are joined this morning by Nicola Murray and her mother, Julia Rusgar. I'm delighted that you have come and are with us. The committee does not routinely hear from petitioners now because of the volume of petitions that we do receive. However, we thought in this particular instance it would be helpful to give Nicola an opportunity to speak to the committee about why her petition is important. And we will also be holding a roundtable session. We actually had hoped that might have been later today, but the availability of other parties who want to participate in that is such that it will be in our first meeting after the summer recess. So we'll be hearing the evidence from Nicola today and continuing the petition to allow us to have that roundtable discussion at the beginning of September. We really are grateful, Nicola, to you and your mother for travelling to the Parliament today. And before we move on to explore the issue further, and we obviously have considered it previously and read the various submissions, I'd very much like, and the committee would very much like, just to give you a few moments to say anything you might like to say, whether prepared or spontaneous or whatever, just by way of an introduction.
Okay, so first of all, thank you for having me here and allowing me to speak to you. I just really wanted to bring this forward after Dr. Mary Neal had submitted evidence for the original domestic abuse bill and it didn't get in. And having the experience that I have personally and the women that I support through my support group, I just felt that it was very important that it does become part of our laws, because it is such an important thing. It is life impacting for the victims, and not just them personally, for their families. So when I lost my pregnancies, I lost a child, I lost children. My children lost siblings, and my parents lost grandchildren. So it impacts the entire family. And obviously afterwards it's deeply traumatising and emotional, because it's not just that you have to deal with the actual loss itself, it's the circumstances of the loss and the fact that the perpetrator can get away so easily with such, often not even being charged at all, or as you know from my own evidence, just really inappropriate sentencing, which is like rubbing salt in the wounds of the victims. It's almost like saying it meant nothing. And that can add further trauma to the victims and their families, because they feel like they haven't received justice. The justice system, unfortunately, does fail on many levels when it comes to domestic violence. And I think it is very important that, as a nation, Scotland can lead the way in that. We already have, in a way, with the Domestic Abuse Bill, which is brilliant in many, many ways, but also there are areas where it could use tightening up. And this perhaps could even be an amendment to the bill, rather than a standalone bill on its own.
I mean, you touched on just briefly in the criminal justice system there. What was your experience of that?
It fails so much. When you report to the police, it's kind of a lottery whether they're going to be knowledgeable about domestic violence and whether they're going to take the matter as seriously as what it is, or whether they're going to try and dissuade you from actually reporting. sometimes you'll be told this is a waste of time, you know, which is wrong. And then if you do go through with reporting, you might get a phone call saying, look, we've had him in, but we can't charge him. The CPS say we've not got enough. The fiscal said we've not got enough. And you're thinking, but I gave you pages and pages of evidence. And then if you do, by some chance of luck, which it becomes a lottery, really, get through to court. Court's quite traumatic. And they do take some steps to lessen the impact, but it is a traumatic process. And, you know, you're having to walk past him in the hallway to get to the special room, and which isn't great. You're having to be, although you might have a screen, you'll have to be in the same room as the person who's done this to you. And I mean, and with the 2013 incident, which I've referenced in my evidence, we were lucky in that respect that we were in the witness muster room when the fiscal came through and told me that he'd changed his plea, but I wasn't told that he'd taken a plea deal to a lesser charge, which meant that his sentence was that he was ordered to pay me £300 compensation for my loss, which still to this day that grates on me, that that was what his punishment was. It just seemed deeply inappropriate considering what had happened and the trauma. My children witnessed what happened to me. They were playing in the garden when it happened. And, you know, my daughter, who was then 8, had to be a witness for the fiscal, which you can understand was very, very traumatic for her, even though in the end she didn't actually have to testify because he changed his plea. But it just seems to me like the law doesn't seem to recognise the impact of the abuse upon the victim.
So did you feel that, obviously you weren't involved in the discussion about the change of plea or
no,
anything like
not
that?
Not at all.
Did you then have a sense that they simply wanted to dispense with the issue rather
yes.
than redress the concern? Well, that they,
absolutely. That's exactly how we felt, that it was just a case of like, get this off the books and on with the next case, rather than actually redress actually what had happened and understand that the impact that it had on the whole family.
And a final question from me, and then we'll invite colleagues to speak. Your experience and the petition you've brought forward here today, has that led you to understand the experience of others as well?
I mean, yes. I mean,
what's your wider kind of experience now of others who have experienced a similar situation?
I run a support group, Brodie's Trust, and I've met hundreds of women, not just in Perth, who come physically to the meetup, but we do Zoom support and online support for women who are in other areas and even not in this country. Some in America, Canada, Australia as well that have had similar, and we all seem to have pretty similar experiences when it comes to getting justice for what's happened to us. It all seems to be failing somehow, and I'm not sure how we fix it exactly. I think it's more listening to survivors and seeing where we can sort of tweak things, because the legislation's certainly there with the domestic abuse bill, and sentencing guidelines just don't seem to be followed when it comes to the sentencing, because a lot of times I'm seeing they'll be told to go on the Caledonian Project, or they'll be told they have to do community service, or they'll be told they have a paltry fine or a compensation order that's much less than sort of £400 or, you know, there or thereabouts. It'll be like one case I'm aware of, he was ordered to bear £50 compensation.
So in your case, In your case, you felt that the value of the lost child you had was quantified at £300 and didn't seem to you to represent a fair or just outcome. Colleagues, can I have an indication of those who might like to speak? Will I come to Paul Sweeney first? Just
thank you, convener. Just it is really harrowing to listen to your personal experience and to recognise how deficient the law in Scotland is in relation to this matter. There was another submission that received by the committee in relation to the fact that the statutory provisions in other parts of the UK are much more strong in relation to this statutory offence of what's known as child destruction as an aggravating factor. So would you say that that provides a good sort of framework for which the law in Scotland could be brought up to the same level?
Yes, to be brought up to the same level as the rest of the UK, because as you rightly state, we're the only nation in the whole of the UK that is deficient in this area. And I really think that we lead the world in a lot of other areas. Scotland is a great country. We could do so much more to lead by example.
Thanks very much. I think the Scottish Government's response didn't really address the primary aggravating factor of the death of an unborn child. It was merely concerned with the offence of domestic abuse, and there was an aggravating factor that could be actually defined in law. Yeah. In some of the cases in Scotland where this has happened, the sentences have been particularly light compared to other parts of the UK. Do you agree that that's a kind of an inadequate response from the Scottish Government?
Yes, I would, yes.
Okay, thanks. I would just also like to ask, just whilst I'm on this line of questioning, you mentioned the idea of an amendment. It wouldn't necessarily need a discrete, complete new act. Can you just develop that a bit more? Sorry, just
Perhaps within the existing domestic abuse bill, we could actually just add in an amendment to strengthen that bill.
Okay, well, that's certainly something that's worth considering. I was just also wanting to maybe just offer a couple of ideas as potential other mechanisms. It's a very good candidate for a member's bill as well, so it might be worth discussion. I'm sure the committee has noted that, but also discussion with your constituents and regional MSPs about someone who might be interested in the idea of sponsoring such a bill. You know, there are certainly MSPs who have been working in this field that might be of interest. It might be of interest to them. So, just another potential mechanism by which to achieve the remedy. But I think I'll maybe rest on that for now.
Okay, that's right. Thank you, Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, convener, and like Paul, I did find your account harrowing, and I'm very sorry that the system really does appear to have let you down, not just in one way, but in several ways. So I just wanted to make that observation, and thank you very much for coming before us on this issue that's so important for many women, sadly. I did want just to pursue the main question, really, I think, which is, should the law be changed, and if so, how? And am I right in saying that you would like to see a specific reference in a new criminal offence to circumstances where the violence or coercive action by the man, in almost every case, I would think, would become a specific offence where that led to the loss of an unborn child? Is that your primary objective in raising this petition?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. I can understand that, and as Mr. Sweeney has just said, you know, that could be done either by the government or it could be done by an individual MSP. I did want to put an alternative to you, which has been raised by those advising us in the Parliament Information Centre and a very helpful paper they provided. And they've suggested that rather than a brand new offence, a specific offence, it would be possible in relation to how the existing offences are worded to require that the charge, the actual words used in the charge against the assailant or the accused, specifically refer to the fact that there has been violence which has led to the loss of an unborn child. In other words, an alternative course of action could be that rather than create a brand new offence, that we would urge that the Scottish Government and the justice system, the Procurator Fiscal and the Lord Advocate, would require that this be specifically mentioned in the wording of the charge. And I wondered if you feel that that might be an acceptable alternative to the creation of a specific offence.
That could be an acceptable alternative, as long as there were mechanisms in place to ensure that police and the fiscal and the sheriffs were actually doing their job in that respect.
Yes. Well, thank you. That's very helpful, because I think that's perhaps a point that colleagues might wish to pursue with the relevant authorities as an alternative. And the Scottish Sentencing Council, in their submission, said that there's nothing precludes the loss of an unborn child caused by violent action or coercive control from being libelled as part of an offence. So they say that could be a route. However, what I think I'm going to ask them, if we have the opportunity, is to say, well, has this ever happened? Has this ever happened in practice? Because if it hasn't, well, indeed, and I don't know the answer to that, but I think it's a point we will pursue to see if we can get justice for you. Just the other area of question I just wanted to ask was that you were faced with the ghastly situation of finding that the charge had been reduced without, as I understand it, without any consultation. And of course, at the end of the day, the prosecutorial system is and is rightly independent. I mean, the people in charge are independent, and rightly so. But do you feel that there should be a requirement for prior communication with the victim of this ghastly circumstance prior to any reduction in the gravity of the offence being agreed, if you like, between the fiscal and the defence lawyer, perhaps?
Absolutely, I do. I think that the victim of the crime is the most important person in the whole process, and that, yes, they should be consulted where things are going to be dropped down to a lesser charge or considered to be dropped down, and that their input and their thoughts and feelings should be considered.
Yes. Well, that's extremely helpful. Thank you very much. And I think these are points that I would be very keen with colleagues to pursue. But thank you for speaking out so clearly today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you. And can I also commend you for your courage today by coming and making the points you've made. You spoke about the difficulties that you had when it came to reporting and dealing with the police and their knock-on effect that they had towards you as a victim. So can I maybe ask about what would you like to see developed within possibly Police Scotland as to how they manage the changes that came in through the Domestic Abuse Act saw them look at priorities within domestic abuse. But within your circumstances, there is still obviously a gap and things fall through the net. So can I ask what you think they should be looking at, or what areas could be developed?
Boils down to one thing: better training. Okay. That's what they need, better training in the subject of domestic violence. It's often still greatly misunderstood by people who say that they know about it. The effects of coercive control especially are greatly misunderstood, especially by police, in my experience.
And following on from that, if there's not the understanding when you're putting forward your case to the police, then when you're trying to then move that forward, and you've expressed the difficulties you had when you went to court, as to how that happens, was there any support mechanism from the police or anybody else for you going through that process?
Not from the police, no.
No.
Only from the VIA and the court.
In the court. So would you what would you see if you had an opportunity to develop some of that and change the law, or change the way that they tackle that process?
I think as a case is going forward, if it's a particularly serious case like that, I think having a named liaison officer is good to keep you up to date with what's happening and to check in with you, because it can be very disheartening. Certainly in my own experience, the perpetrator had contacted me several times breaching his bail conditions during the wait to go to court, trying to coerce me into meeting with him and trying to coerce me into not testifying. And a lot of times it was, he was arrested, he was a night in the cells, he was back out the next day doing the exact same thing again and again. There was one officer who was really good, and he spoke to me down the phone and he went, "Do not feel guilty for one second, he knows what he's doing, and you did the right thing in reporting." And that really helped change my mindset at that time. So I think it is important that police are supporting the victims of crime as well.
And you talked about your own sort of peer group that you've set up, and do you liaise with any of the authorities yourself? Do you go out to them, or do they come to you?
No, I do try to, but they tend to be quite dismissive of me. I do try to, because a lot of times, a lot of the ladies that are coming to me, they're having difficulty with trying to get police to take it seriously enough to come out and take a statement, or, you know, police are not keeping them up to date, or they've taken a statement and they're not even bothered charging the individual. So kind of chasing up things on behalf of ladies and even accompanying them to court. I'm just seeing my own scenario playing out
again and again.
And I just thought, I need to do something.
You're right. If lessons have not been learned,
and
situation isn't changing, then something needs to be done to try and make that happen. And what you're attempting to do is bridge that gap. So by doing that, I commend you for all that you've done so far and by coming here today, because that gives us an opportunity then to think about how we can progress this and where it can go to. But the last thing would be, you know, you talked about compensation and things of that nature.
I would have rathered that my perpetrator went to jail and that that gave us the safety and the breathing space to heal from what he had done, rather than him being out and being able to just carry on.
And you said when you spoke, you talked about it belittled the whole process by putting a monetary sum against that situation. And
I
that's
don't think
not
there
the
is any sum of money that can compensate for such a loss.
Exactly. Thank you.
I mean, the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service say, you know, there are six cases where domestic abuse led to the loss of a child. And obviously, you've come here this morning with a very strong person, if I may say, supported by your mother, obviously with a family. For some of the other women, I imagine the circumstances must be very different. And the lack of that support network will leave them hugely exposed. And I wonder too, with some of the women with whom you are engaged, whether this lack of direction or seriousness as they report the case leaves them feeling exposed and at further risk.
It does.
And if that is one of the if you feel that is a very significant factor, perhaps, in the underreporting or the non-pursuit of a number of these issues.
Absolutely. The way that the system works puts a lot of women off reporting. They feel that it's not taken seriously. They feel that they're dismissed or even blamed sometimes. Often, quite a lot of police officers will ask the question, "What did you do to make him do that?" That question should never be asked. Never. They do feel very let down, very vulnerable. I mean, after the loss of a child in any circumstances, you will feel vulnerable and you'll feel this need to be protected. And I was very lucky that I have such an amazing family, and my mum has been tremendous as a support. I really do not know what I would have done without her. But a lot of women that I engage with, they don't have family support for whatever reason. They may have had to flee their home and their support network of friends and things, and they feel very vulnerable, very let down, very hopeless almost at times. And I do feel that that's something that we really need to change. We have an opportunity here to do that, and whatever we can do, whether that's by a member's bill, an amendment, or creating an act, I think we really need to.
Well, thank you. I mean, I think your testimony has been compelling this morning. I know that there's an opportunity. Paul, sorry, you have a further question you'd like to ask?
No, it was just... Thank you, Convener. It was just in reading the papers, there was a mention made about the Scottish Law Commission's current work programme includes two projects, one on homicide and one on aspects of family law, which come close to the topic of the petition, but that neither covers the actual issue raised. So I was just suggesting perhaps another avenue to explore might be a meeting with the Scottish Law Commission, if this committee might be able to facilitate such a meeting to discuss those projects and how that might be able to interface with the particular issue and deficiency that you've obviously highlighted today.
I'd be happy to do that, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Well, as I said, thank you. Your testimony has been compelling this morning. We will be meeting again after September with a round table with various representative groups. So we'll be keeping the petition open, and we'll be seeking to take the issues raised in it forward. And I wonder, colleagues, it occurs to me too that this may very well be a subject that the committee might wish to put before the chamber in a full chamber debate once we've heard a little bit further about all of this, and to in that way bring the government to the chamber to discuss with us the issues that it has explored in the autumn. That might be another route for us to take forward. So, Nicola, thank you very much. Julie, thank you for coming with us, and I suspend this session for the moment. continue with item one, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1860, New Legislation for Prescription and Limitation Act, lodged by Jennifer Morrison Holden. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Prescription and Limitation Act to allow retrospective claims to be made. We last considered this petition on the 18th of May, and we agreed to write to the Scottish Government. And following our previous consideration, we've received our response from the Minister for Community Safety, which members will have noted in their papers. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that while the Scottish Government has undertaken to keep this area of law under review, existing legislation already allows the courts to override principal limitation time limits when it is persuaded that it is equitable to do so, and that the Scottish Government has no plans to collect and evaluate information on the use of judicial discretion under Section 19A of the Prescription and Limitation Scotland Act 1973.
Colleagues, are we minded? We are. So we thank the petitioner for raising the petition, but we will close the petition under Rule 15.7 for the reasons that David Torrance has suggested, and we are agreed. Colleagues, we now consider a number of continuing petitions that arise out of the evidence session that we held last meeting. The first of these is petition number 1864 to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms. This was lodged by Aileen Jackson on behalf of Scotland Against Spin, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms by adopting English planning legislation for the determination of onshore wind farm developments, by empowering local authorities to ensure local communities are given sufficient professional help to engage in the planning process, and by appointing an independent advocate to ensure that local participants are not bullied and intimidated during public inquiries. We last considered this, as I said a moment ago, on the 15th of June, when we also heard from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth and his officials. And at that meeting, we explored the need for the engagement with the UK government in pursuing changes to the Electricity Act, which might enable decisions on onshore wind farm developments to be taken at a local authority level. We also heard about efforts to encourage earlier engagement with communities in the planning process with a greater emphasis on collaboration, and also about attempts to shift the dial away from conflict between communities and developers. Since that meeting, we've now received a new submission from the petitioner in which she shares reflections on the evidence that we heard. And I wonder, therefore, if members have any comments or suggestions in relation to this particular petition 1864. And David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee could write to the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth to follow up on the outstanding issues from the evidence session on the 15th of June 2022. This includes any recent discussions the Scottish Government may have held with the UK Government regarding issues raised in this petition, and to write to the Planning Advisory Service, PAS, regarding the training they provide to staff and volunteers supporting communities engaging in the planning processes. And also I'd like us to write to the Scottish Government's Planning and Environmental Appeals Division, DPEA, and ask what training and guidance is provided to reporters specifically in relation to how witnesses are treated during public inquiries.
Do colleagues have any further suggestions to make? Are we content with the suggestions raised? We are. Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, Convener. It was just interesting that there was an idea that the petition has been conflated. Some issues were mixed up around devolved and reserved competences. And I thought that was worthwhile trying to unpack a bit, and maybe in relation to some of the discussion. Certainly, I raised some questions around interaction between the Scottish ministers and UK government ministers, and particularly Alistair Jack and Greg Hands. So I wonder whether it's worth inviting those respective ministers to offer a view regarding the Electricity Act and provisions therein. Because I often think when you actually test some of these things, for technical matters, they're often just devolved.
Yeah.
Because people go, oh, actually, that's probably better over there. You know.
I'm quite happy that we do that, because I do agree there were some issues raised that you're quite correct. So we'll incorporate that as well. Petition 1885, make offering community shared ownership mandatory for all wind farm development planning proposals, and this was lodged by Karen Murphy, and calls on the Scottish Government to make community share ownership a mandatory requirement to be offered as part of all proposals for wind farm development. And this too we considered on the 15th of June, and during the evidence session the committee raised the importance of community shared ownership as a method of raising funds at local level for people in their communities. And the committee questioned whether the Minister had engaged with the UK Government, and I think these are issues again that Paul Sweeney's just raised, to seek approval for amendments to the Electricity Act so that it can mandate community shared ownership. And the Minister indicated that such conversations had not taken place in relation to community energy. We've also a recent submission from the petitioner reiterating her view that raising a land tax could be a route to mandate community shared ownership. And I'm happy to suggest that we write to the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth to follow up on these outstanding issues, and again to raise the issue of any recent discussions that the Scottish Government may have had with the UK Government in relation to the issues raised in the petition. Happy to ask the Minister what role he thinks local place plans and early community engagement in the planning process can play. And I'm also happy that we asked the Minister for his views on the petitioner's suggestion that developers must be offer and secure 15% community shared ownership investment. Are there any further suggestions from the committee? Are we content to those? Yeah, we are. Again, petition number 1902 on behalf of Maria Aitken, on behalf of the Caithness. We're moving on. Is that a separate one altogether?
No, I think Fergus wanted to come in.
Oh, Fergus, apologies.
Sorry, Jackson, I wasn't sure if you could hear me there. I've just, whilst agreeing to the courses of action that you've just outlined in relation to petition 1885, I wonder, given that that energy is a policy issue that rests really substantially with the Minister for Energy, we should also write to him as well. And I wonder if in doing so, and indeed writing to both ministers, we might ask if there are any plans that the Scottish Government has to provide additional funding to enable communities to pursue an interest in community ownership, and in particular, perhaps whether the Scottish National Investment Bank, which operates commercially but has a green mandate, if you like, could be requested to provide an element or a tranche of funding from which communities might be able to draw, as well as raising money from other sources, such as private banks and so on and so forth. So it occurred to me that in order to pursue what the petitioner wants, these related aspects are also relevant, and perhaps ones that we could seek the government's, Scottish Government's views upon as to whether they have additional plans to help enable community ownership of renewable energy projects to become far more prevalent than it is at the moment.
Yes, fine. Very happy to incorporate that as well. Thank you, Fergus Ewing. We'll do that too. Members content with that proposal? Okay, that brings us to, I'm just checking where we were at there, to 1902, and that is to allow appeal process for community participation requests. Sorry, I'm just trying to, this is the petition that, I was just trying to think which petition Rhoda Grant was joining us for, and that's what was throwing me in. It is this petition that you're joining us for this morning, Rhoda Grant. This was lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of the Caithness Health Community Action Team, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow an appeal process for community participation requests under the Community Empowerment Act 2015. And despite me scurrying around in my notes now tell me that Rhoda Grant is joining us for this petition. We last considered it on the 20th of April, you colleagues will remember, when we had a roundtable discussion. We discovered that the Scottish Community Development Centre has been undertaking a work on participation requests. We agreed to write to them to request more information on this work programme, specifically on how the working group will report its findings. And the response indicates that a number of proposals have emerged, including models for local reviews, appeals and mediation. Its work is ongoing, with the potential to deliver additional promotional work surrounding participation requests, as well as supporting outcome improvement processes. And this will include further community engagement in relation to reviews and appeals. And I wonder, Rhoda Grant, if there's anything you'd like to contribute to our consideration of the petition at this point.
Yes, I'm heartened that this work is ongoing, but I guess I'm disappointed that it's taking this long, because CHAT do fulfil the expectation of a community body. So they should actually have that request. They should be involved in decision-making and have that request agreed. So I think we probably have to wait and see. Maybe I would ask if you would write to the Scottish Government and see when they would be, what timeline they would be proposing to take action to put in a change to the, or put in an appeal process, because that's a problem. We know CHAT should be accepted, but the trouble is there is no appeals process when they're not accepted. So I wonder if we could ask the Scottish Government, one, when they hope to be in a position to instigate an appeals process. But also, could they issue some guidance or something in the interim, just so that we could get CHAT where they should be, because they do a huge amount of work locally. They're trusted by their community. And I think it would be really helpful if they were round the table with NHS Highland. You know, you've heard petitioners from the north here on other issues before, and CHAT would be well able to represent their views with NHS Highland, and we might not be in the position where people feel that they can only petition this parliament to try and get some action. I think it might cut through some of the concerns people have.
Okay, thank you. Colleagues, I mean, I'm quite happy to write to the Scottish Government along the lines suggested by Rhoda Grant on this occasion, and I think once we've done that and seen the response, we'll be in a better position to decide what further we can do in relation to the petition. I certainly think that we would want or suggest to the petitioner that in due course, after we've taken this element of it forward, that it may well be that they want to monitor the work of this group and see whether or not a fresh petition is required at a later date. But we will write to the Scottish Government in the first instance along the line suggested. Thank you very much for that suggestion, Rhoda Grant. Petition number 1917, to provide full legal aid to parents fighting for access to their children. This is the last of our continuing petitions this morning. And it's been lodged by Amy Stevenson, and calls on Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide full legal aid to all parents who are fighting for access to their children, regardless of income. We last considered this petition on the 18th of May. We agreed to write to the Scottish Government seeking more information on the review of the legal aid system, and also on their plans for a provisional timetable for bringing forward the Legal Aid Reform Bill. Since then, we have received a response from the Scottish Government, and that was included in our meeting papers for this morning. And I wonder whether members have any suggestions as to how we might respond in accordingly. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I would propose that under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, on the basis that the Scottish Government intends to introduce the Legal Aid Reform Scotland Bill during this Parliament, that we close the petition. And in closing the petition, the committee may wish to highlight to the petitioner that they can contact their local MSPs about pursuing amendments to the bill once introduced, to ensure that the issues raised in the petition are fully considered.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Does that meet with the general approval of the committee? It does. We agree. Thank you. So we will close the petition and write accordingly to the petitioner with the suggestions that Mr. Stewart has made. That brings us to item two this morning, which is the consideration of new petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1930, 1930. Getting to my mother's age now. Ensure customers are always given information on cheapest possible fare in new ScotRail contract. The first of our new petitions today is to do exactly that, and it's lodged by George Ecton. And it is a petition calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that a requirement of future rail contracts is for customers to be given information on the cheapest possible fare, as a matter of course, and recognise the vital role of the existing ticket office estate in delivering on this aim. Members will be aware from our previous predecessor committee considered a similar petition from Mr Ecton last session, and this was closed on the basis that the Scottish Government had committed to introduce an obligation on the operator to provide customers with clear, straightforward information on all fare options, including identification of the cheapest possible fare. In his written submission accompanying this petition, Mr Ecton highlights that the previous commitment made by the Scottish Government has yet to be fulfilled, and has suggested that as ScotRail is now in public ownership, the property of the Scottish Government, it should be subject to the consumer duty. Mr Ecton has also suggested amending the price promise guarantee to further assist passengers in accessing the lowest possible fare for their journey. And I wonder, in balance and considering the evidence, whether colleagues have any suggestions or comments for action. Paul Sweeney looks like he's bursting to step forward with a suggestion. I may have misread his signs there, but he looks...
I just think, certainly, when you look at alternative technologies available in other jurisdictions, particularly in London, where there's an automatic fare capping system in place, which was introduced maybe 5 or 6 years ago, there are technological solutions out there which can offer a remedy, particularly with the intra-Scotland travel as opposed to, you know, travel to the other parts of the UK. So perhaps it is worth inviting submissions from the likes of Transport for London about their fare capping technology and how that's been rolled out. And perhaps that could offer a basis for how this could be delivered in Scotland.
I think that seems a very eminently sensible suggestion. Colleagues are commit. Any other suggestions? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. To write to Scottish Government to seek clarification on whether there are plans to extend the consumer duty to include ScotRail now that the company is in public ownership. And in writing to the Scottish Government, the committee may also wish to ask for a further update on the fares review, specifically the timeline for completing the review, and to ask what action has been undertaken to strengthen the commitments to a price promise guarantee.
OK, so those recommendations, any further? Mr Sweeney?
Just add on that correspondence, the Scottish Government may be ascertaining their view on the fare capping, tap-in, tap-out type technology. I know it's been promoted for buses in Scotland, yeah, but I haven't heard much in relation to rail.
You can do that too. Thank you very much. We're agreed. Petition number 1934, to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. And this has been lodged by Craig Schooler on behalf of Greenfalls High School Rights and Equalities Committee. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with the with Education Scotland to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. And this resource should educate on the causes of gender-based violence and ensure that young people leave school with the tools to help create a safer society for women. Statistics on gender-based violence are included in the petition background information, and the petitioner states that educating our children will end any existing cycles of gender-based violence and prevent any new ones from starting, unquote. The Scottish Government's response outlines existing resources and guidance relevant to the petition. This includes learning about topics such as gender-biased expectations in primary school, up to sexual harassment and feminism in high school. And it also states that the Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group will review existing resources, identify effective practice examples and develop new resources. So, on the balance of the evidence we've received on an important petition, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think we need to communicate with the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to find out specifics about this whole area, and whether there is the planned independent review on sexual harassment and gender-based violence petition, and the practice that covers that to be set out in the petition. And I think also it's important to find out from the Scottish Government, Education Scotland, how they monitor children and young people who are being consulted on the curriculum across Scotland in line with the Scottish Government's best practice, and whether the Scottish Government currently monitors data in relation to sexual assault on schools across Scotland. And for details on the membership, I think that's also quite important. We need to find out the membership of the Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group. So if we could possibly require all of these, that would give us a much better outlook and understanding of where the Scottish Government is with this whole process and how they're progressing it themselves.
Thank you. Do we have any other suggestions from colleagues? Paul Sweeney?
Perhaps it'd be worth writing to COSLA and also the 32 local authority education services to ascertain what provision they make within their schools, and perhaps that could help establish, you know, a pattern of activity.
Right to causal in the first instance. Yeah. Agreed. Thank you. Petition number 1935, create an independent committee to judge whether Scottish ministers have broken the ministerial code. This new petition is lodged by Dylan Crawford, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a committee outside the Parliament to judge whether ministers have broken the ministerial code. The petitioner considers that a committee of non-MSPs would be able to act independently as they are not affiliated with a party. The Scottish Government's submission details the process by which ministers are held to account. Ministers are bound by the Scottish Ministerial Code, and a group of independent advisers currently exists to provide the First Minister with advice on which to base judgments in relation to conduct. I think this is an interesting petition. It's obviously motivated by current events. And I wonder, colleagues, whether in the first instance we might invite Spice to do a little bit of further work on how the different parliaments within the UK currently process and deal with these with this business, because I really don't know where the Scottish system sits in with the system in Northern Ireland, Wales, or the rest of the UK. And I think the petitioner probably and the public feel there's a slight lack of transparency around how all these arrangements have arisen. And I think it would be useful for us at least to pull that work together and have a look at that as we consider the petition further. Colleagues content with that? Yeah, fine. And that brings us to our final petition this morning, petition number 1938, to introduce compulsory microchipping of cats in Scotland. And this has been lodged by Carly Power. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce the mandatory microchipping of cats in Scotland and assess the effectiveness of current microchip scanning processes. We are joined today by the Parliament's most famous cat owner, Christine Graham, MSP. Welcome, Christine. The Scottish Government has indicated that it is working alongside the other UK administrations on welfare issues, including consideration of microchipping cats. They advise that officials are following DEFRA proposals in this area and will give full consideration to the recent consultation results and any proposed legislation. The petitioner actually welcomes the Scottish Government response and states that she is satisfied that the current approach will adequately address the issue of mandatory microchipping. She does raise the issue of mandatory scanning and highlights that standards have been falling below best practice. The petitioner cites a lack of understanding and training in relation to scanning equipment as a potential reason for falling standards and says no official guidance is in place for councils on this issue. Now, the Spice briefing we've received highlights the UK government's consultation, which addressed scanning, and generally it found broad support for improvements to the process, but raised both positive and negative impacts arising from compulsory scanning. And I think it quite likely that the Scottish Government, having indicated that they are looking closely at the consultation in relation to microchipping and scanning, will be inclined to follow whatever final course the UK Government chooses to in relation to this issue. Christine Graham, is there anything you would like to say in relation to this petition this morning?
Yes, I'd like to add a bit because obviously, there's a distinction between dogs being microchipped, which is for a variety of reasons compulsory, but also it makes it easier about dog control notices and so on. And cats are a different kettle of fish. I don't know why I mentioned fish with cats, but there we are. But it's a welfare issue for cats, and it's also a responsible ownership issue. If I can briefly tell you a very short story, convener, is that many years ago, when my son went out in the garden and found a cat in the pouring rain under the bushes, and we had two cats of our own at the time, and we brought it in and we kept it safe overnight, and it was obvious this cat was very ill, and we took it down to the vets, and the vet said, this is a very, very old cat, it's dying, it's got kidney failure. And my son and I burst into tears, and the vet said, how long have you known the cat? And we said, 24 hours. But it didn't matter. It was the fact. But the point of that story is the owner would never know. The cats quite often disappear to die. My own one did that, went down the garden, I found them. So they go away from the house. And I think from the point of view of an owner, either if a cat is injured, killed on the road, or just disappears to die quietly away from its normal place, which is natural for a cat, it's very upsetting for the cat owner to never know what actually happened. The same when cats actually adopt another household, which has been known to happen. They just wander off and decide, the food's better here, I think I'll stay. And again, if they were microchipped, at least the owner would know where they've gone. Now, I'm not obsessed with cats. Let's make this plain. But, you know, I do think it's terribly important. And I commend the various charities who actually, if you're going to get a rescue cat, and Mr. Smokey, who is very famous, of course, the SSPCA charge you to have the cat neutered, and which they usually aren't, and to have the cat microchipped. So it's a welfare issue. It's responsible ownership. And I note that if I look at the government's report on this response to it, the Animal Welfare Commission says in its July 2021 work plan, amongst, quotes, potential areas of work in the medium term, is to consider welfare aspects of microchipping domestic cats, compulsory neutering of cats and outdoor cat controls and so on. Now, it seems to me that's a light touch, potential areas. And if I may ask the committee if they would consider writing to the Animal Welfare Commission to see if there's anything more solid they're proposing to do regarding this issue. I appreciate the other matters that you've raised about scanning and so on. And as far as I understand it, there is no cost. There shouldn't be a cost to the public person, this, because for vets, if an animal's taken to the vets and they don't know who it is, they can scan it and you find the owner. The main thing is that you bring the details on the microchip up to date if you move. And finally, if you have a cat flap, and I'm not advertising various manufacturing devices, if you have a cat flap that identifies microchips, then your cat can come in and out the house with no other cat coming in. Mr. Smokey has that protection from any invaders. And so only he can come in and out the cat flap, and I'm sure he's very happy with that. So there are a whole range of issues that I would like to see it compulsory. Every time you talk about cats, people sort of smile at you, but many of us love the wee devils. Thank you.
I'm very grateful to you for that, Christine Graham. I think we've taken note of one or two areas that we might pursue. I'm just wondering what the consequences would be for us all if we could all relocate to the house or the street where the food was better.
I'm sorry.
Might provoke a few controversies.
Convener, I think I'll be in touch with Mrs. Carlow.
Well, Mr. Carlow does all the cooking, so it might actually be... that might be a disastrous outcome. But I'm grateful to that. Are there any other suggestions that colleagues might like to make in addition to the one that we've received from Christine Graham? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. As somebody who adopted a cat 11 years ago, or should I say a cat adopted me, I should never have fed it tuna or chicken, you know that. I must confess to pinching somebody's cat all this time ago. But I would also like to write to the Scottish Government seeking a view on the additional evidence provided by a petitioner and Spice regarding the compulsory scanning of cat microchips in Scotland, if that's acceptable to the committee.
OK. And it is? Is it? I see. Fergus, are you nodding your head in agreement to that? Yes, I think you are. In which case, then, well, that is what we will do. We'll keep the petition open.
Through the Animal Welfare Commission to see if they have a more specific timetable, because that's all, what I have in your briefing. It's rather casual what they're saying just now.
We will do that as well.
Thank you very much.
And that leads us to conclude the public section of our meeting this morning. The next public session will take place on Wednesday, the 14th of September. With or without Mr. Smokey as a guest. And we now move into private session. Thank you all.